Great. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us for tonight's webinar. If you can hear me, please go ahead and press the heart emoticon at the bottom of this video. And also let us know where you're joining us from. It'll be great to know where our community members are joining us. So go ahead and please press the heart emoticon. Let us know where you're from. And this also allows our expands and our reach to increase on Facebook and to allow other community members to access this educational webinar. Thank you so much to my colleagues at the CPA, especially Deanna and Pascal, who have been working tirelessly to bring this together. It's my honor to be here with you today, along with my esteemed panelists. I'll take some time to just introduce myself and the CPA, and then I'll give a chance to Carlos, Larry, and Pete to introduce themselves. So my name is Salimeh Tabrizi. I'm one of the founding members of the Canadian Psychedelic Association, and I'm also a clinical counselor. I specifically work with individuals who have gone through transformational journeys with plant medicine, and I also support them with their integration. It's my honor to lead this webinar tonight, especially in the times that we are in. This is a historical time for both the US and Canada in regards to decriminalization. And yes, we are also, as we all know, in quite the bottleneck for human evolution and the challenges that we're facing globally and locally. The topic for this webinar is decolonizing drug decriminalization policy and reform. So without further ado, I'll allow our esteemed panelists to introduce themselves, and then I'll give a quick agenda of what we're going to be covering today in our hour and a half to 2 hours. So I'll start with Carlos Plazola. Please, Carlos, let us know a little bit about your background and why you're doing what you're doing.
Thank you. Yeah, so I am Carlos Plazola. I was born and raised in San Jose, California, and in Jalisco, Mexico. I'm the child of immigrants who came to the U.S. I experienced a number of trauma that are experienced in the Mexican and Chicano community of the United States, particularly around addiction. This presentation is very near and dear to my heart because I do what I do in Decrim Nature as the chair of Decriminalized Nature in the United States because of the healing effects of plant medicines. A number of my family members have been incarcerated because of drugs. They've been, I have a number of close, very close family members who have suffered from addiction. A number of them who are still very young and emerging into their young adulthood who have already started experimenting with high addiction drugs and alcohol. And so for me, this really is about providing healing modalities that have worked for people that I love and also for myself. My background, I have a master's in environmental science from Yale University. I have a bachelor's from UCLA in biology and anthropology. I've worked for 10 years as a social justice organizer, 10 years as a political aide, including chief of staff to the Oakland City Council, and also 15 years in private business. Again, I do what I do here with Decrim Nature out of love and to honor the healing opportunities in the plant medicines.
Great. Thank you so much, Carlos. And then I will actually ask Counselor Pete Fry to share his background. And I want to really honor and thank each one of you. I know both Counselor Pete Fry is actually in council right now, and he's taken this hour to be with us and update us. And I know Carlos and Larry, you guys are just tirelessly working and giving your heart and your efforts to this, to the Decrim Nature movement in the United States. So I wanted to really honor and acknowledge all of you. Pete, go ahead, please.
Thanks, Salome. And technically, I'm in my dinner break, so spares don't have to worry that I'm still working. This is my dinner break. My name is Pete Fry. I'm a Vancouver City Councilor, first term, 2 years in. I'm here in Vancouver, British Columbia, which has long been the epicenter of drug war, addiction crisis, opioid overdoses. We've really been front and center in a lot of these issues. Certainly here in Canada, we were the first city in North America to introduced a safe injection site, which we now call supervised injection services. And that was a big game changer. And that was in direct response to the HIV crisis of the day and overdoses and just the increasing human toll. Today, we see obviously a significant increase in overdose deaths directly as a result of toxic drug supply. So since the introduction of fentanyl into the system, we've seen a pretty significant increase in overdose deaths and traumatic brain injuries as a result of overdose. Since the last 4 years, we declared, in 2016, we declared a public health emergency in the province of British Columbia. Here in Vancouver alone, since that time, we've had 1,536 overdose deaths. This year alone, I think it's 300 and almost 70 overdose deaths this year. And I know we just had a coroner's report update today, as a matter of fact, with new numbers. So it's a startling impact on a broad cross-section of our city and of our province. It's gone from a point where at one point we were talking about sort of a very unique and distinct population, and we've seen with fentanyl that it is transcended just the sort of traditional intravenous drug using population to all sectors of society. And we're seeing a real rippling effect of British Columbians and Vancouverites paying more attention to this. So this became a critical election issue when I ran in 2018, and it's still something that has seen unanimous support with the Mayor's Overdose Task Force that was introduced shortly after we were elected, unanimous support across council, and looking at how we can more proactively address this. Since the time, and also in the context of COVID, we've seen the introduction at a provincial level of a safe supply initiative to try and get non-toxic drug supply to folks who use drugs. That's had limited success in no small part because of some of the challenges with the criminalization of drug possession. And so, in fact, today, what I'm on the break from is hearing speakers on the mayor's motion, which was just introduced yesterday, for decriminalization of possession in Vancouver, and looking for an exemption in the federal government scheme, because it's obviously the drug laws dictated by the federal government. So we're looking for an exemption. We're discussing it today, and I suspect it will pass unanimously. It's certainly between synthetics and that sort of missing link around safe supply, this is really a critical intervention for us. So that's what we're working on right now in Vancouver.
Great. Thank you so much, Pete. And Pete, it's a little bit, the volume is a bit low. If you could adjust the microphone, we definitely want to hear everything you have to say. Great. Okay. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. And without further ado, Larry Norris.
Hello, everyone. Nice to meet everybody. Thank you, Councilmember Fry, for being here today, especially on your dinner break. We appreciate it. Hello, everybody. Nice to see you. My name is Larry Norris. I am co-founder with Carlos with Decriminalize Nature in the U.S. here. I started off this sort of exploration in my undergrad at the University of Michigan, where I studied biopsychology and cognitive science, which is what neuroscience was before neuroscience existed. This is from 94 to 98. In that process, I was also having some pretty profound entheogenic experiences, and it was pretty stark contrast between what I was learning in class about neuroscience and what I was actually having my experiences and the profound ability to transform personal challenges and things like that. And so I realized there was a lot more to this conversation than I was learning in class. From this point, I decided I wanted to sort of dive a little deeper into this research. So I took about a 11-year sabbatical and explored a little bit more things like ayahuasca and other sort of entheogenic plants across the planet. I currently just this spring graduated with my dissertation looking at ayahuasca experiences and integration, or the meaning-making process, and how important it is for people to be able to develop their own meaning-making during these experiences so that we don't have paradigms that are sort of, you know, conflicting with some of the experiences and maybe dismiss or devalue some of the spiritual or sacred aspects of the experience. About 9 years ago, I also co-founded an organization called ERIE, which is Entheogenic Research, Integration, and Education. We're a nonprofit here in the U.S., and we have developed different models for peer integration circles, coming together in sort of a circle atmosphere to be able to share experiences with each other, which helps to reduce the alienation and isolation that people feel when they have big and profound experiences. We also do educational events, so we've held, I don't know, We have probably about 120 or 130 different educational videos online of scholars from across the planet, whether it's indigenous scholars, whether it's medical practitioners, whether it's philosophers, or other type of people who have been touched by these plant and fungi experiences. So through that process, I met Carlos in December of 2018, and we, along with a group of other of us, started this project to decriminalize nature. And we've been pretty excited at the progress that's happened so far, and especially even now making movements during this sort of corona time when we're not really able as easily to contact people in the city council office. Still, things are happening, and it's really been a really exciting year for us. So thank you all for being here, and I look forward to sharing more.
Great. Thank you so much, Larry, and each one of you for sharing. So a bit of a background into the agenda today. One of the reasons why CPA came together was that we realized that the psychedelic space needed to have a uniform voice within Canada for us to really come together and to have this momentum to make the changes that we need in our society and in our communities. And one of the initiatives of the CPA is the Decriminalize Nature movement. And we were, you know, my colleague Trevor Miller, who is usually right here with me, I want to send out a hello to him. He's working with a client very closely right now. And so that's why he's only here with us in spirit. But we were very inspired by the work that was being done in the United States with the initiative that was being led by Carlos, Larry, and their team. And the wins that they received in Oakland, partially in what happened with Denver, as well as like the work that was done in Santa Cruz, and now most recently in Ann Arbor and Washington, D.C. And so they were working closely with their municipal governments to bring the entheogenic and fungi decriminalization forward. Now, in Canada, what took place for us is that we actually went to the to Vancouver's council meeting as well on September 11th of 2019. And that's where we actually met Councillor Pete Fry for the first time. And that was our initial point of contact. And then we said, well, let's bring this movement to the federal government. So we created a petition and nearly got close to 15,000 signatures. So thank you to everyone who's watching this and has signed that petition and had your voices heard. The petition was read in the House of Commons, and which was initiated by MP Paul Manley. And after the petition was read, we have 45 days to wait until the government responded. And they recently have responded. And I just want to share that with you all as an update on what's happening on the Canadian side. So I'll read this. The Canadian government has responded to our community's decriminalized nature petition, saying no amendments to the current legislation or regulations are required. The CPA disagrees with their response because it is not evidence-based and not consistent with the public evidence-informed statements of BC Premier John Horgan, Vancouver Mayor Kennedy Stewart, the Canadian Association of Chiefs of Police, the Canadian Drug Policy Coalition, and the Provincial Health Officer for British Columbia, Dr. Bonnie Henry. After decades of destruction from the failed war on drugs, we feel science and evidence should take the lead, and we ask the government to reconsider, remove the politics, and allow the academics and scientists who understand these issues to allow the healing for the community to begin. And so this is what has recently taken place. And then we were so surprised to hear that Mayor Kennedy actually released the motion for decriminalization in Vancouver. And as Pete Fry mentioned, Vancouver has always been on the forefront of harm reduction. And we'll get into a little bit of that further later. But at this time, I wanted to pass the baton over to Carlos and Larry for them to share with us their successes and what allowed this grassroots movement in the States to have such great momentum.
Good. Thank you. Should I go first, Carlos?
I think we have a two-part presentation. Larry will take the first part, give an overview of the movement, and then I'll dig into the how we believe we can be support to the drug policy reform movement.
Great. Thank you, everyone. So before I begin with the the success of the Decriminalize Nature movement, I'd like to offer a brief overview of the history of sacred plants and fungi across the planet, which have been stripped away from humanity due to colonization well before synthetic drugs and current drug policy reform existed. People across the world have known about the physical, psychological, and spiritual benefits of sacred plants and fungi for a long time. For example, over 11,000 years ago, there's a cave painting in Africa from 9,000 BC in Algeria where they show mushrooms all across the body of the individual. At least 5,000-year-old cacti traditions exist throughout the Americas, with one of them being the Wiradjuri and peyote, and also many other groups through Central and South America that have worked with cacti-containing mescaline such as San Pedro. In Europe, plants and mushroom traditions were silenced long ago and also went underground. In fact, the word shaman comes from the word semen, meaning one who knows, and it's from the Tunguski region of northern Siberia, which are part of the Finno-Ugric language system, the same language system as my ancestors in Finland. Ayahuasca in South America is a little bit more recent because it is a natural technology that developed creating an orally active dimethyltryptamine by combining two different plants together rather than just picking and eating. So there's a little bit of a technology and knowledge that came from that. Some theorize this was developed over many years of experimentation as cultural exchange and trade connected people who could share their plants and learn together through their interactions. For example, a culture that chewed the Banisteriopsis copy vine came across a culture that worked with DMT snuff, and they realized that these effects could be modulated with each other. Exchanges such as these are examples of our coevolution with nature and are critical to building contemporary cultures that include entheogenic practices. Even in California, there's a long history of mushroom use. While not described in any anthropological literature, Decriminalized Nature board member Shane Norte from the Morongo Band has shown us a picture of a mushroom petroglyph that's been on his ancestral land from long ago. What we want to acknowledge here is that long-held traditions by all of our ancestors across the globe who are in deep relationship with entheogenic plants and mushroom allies. These interactions emerge from a deep connection with nature and the land. To be able to develop one's own relationship to nature is part of the experience of being a human being on planet Earth. Today, scientific studies are showing benefits for a multitude of conditions, supporting what plant medicine people have known for centuries, including being able to help people with substance abuse challenges and things like that. Decriminalized nature has also shown that people want to right their relationship with nature by decriminalizing entheogenic plants and fungi. As Salimeh mentioned, Oakland passed in June of 2019, Santa Cruz passed in January of 2020, and recently, in September of 2020, Ann Arbor passed. What was interesting about Ann Arbor is they did such a good job with their educational campaign that 1 week after they passed, the county commissioner, the county prosecutor also stated that he would not prosecute for the entire county of Washtenaw County, Michigan. Decriminalized Nature model has now received a 25-0 unanimous support from all the city council members through the educational campaign so far. And this is local leadership, local empowered leadership that's engaging in interaction with their city council. Also, most recently, Washington, D.C. passed a ballot initiative in November of 2020 with overwhelming support from the public, receiving 76% of the vote. Decriminalized Nature advocates for a grow-gather-gift model to ensure equitable access for all people to be able to have the self-agency to engage in their own healing process and connect in nature in the way that works for them and is culturally relevant. However, certain policies move forward and psychedelic pharmaceutical and publicly traded companies emerge every day, we must be cautious and be aware of who benefits from the creation of scarcity rather than abundance. For example, a recent article just out today in Oregon is discussing the legality of foraging wild entheogenic mushrooms, which grow abundantly in Oregon and I imagine also in Vancouver. While successfully changing policy for possession and therapeutic approaches, neither M109 or M110 end the prohibition of growing or gathering or sharing in community or ceremony, potentially leaving the citizens dependent upon state-controlled access and removing us further away from our direct connection to nature. One thing that we do encourage with any decriminalization policy is to end the prohibition of home growing and community ceremony, which would be allowing people to share with each other, because it allows people to build their own cultural relationship with entheogenic plants and fungi, with no more regulation than if one was growing their own tomato garden. It's really exciting to be here. I really look forward to hearing more from Councilmember Fry, and thank you all. And we look forward to seeing more movement here in the U.S. and in Canada.
Sally, may I have screen share capabilities?
I believe that you'll get that from Deanna.
Okay, thank you. And as well as I'm getting that, I'll just give a bit of background. My presentation carries from Larry's and grounds it a bit more in an urban community, specifically Oakland. As background, as a chief of staff to the council member representing a largely Latino and African-American district, I came to understand very deeply and personally the sources of the trauma in our community that led to engagement in drug crimes and in behaviors that led to addiction, as well as activities that were deemed to be criminal related to drugs and to high levels of incarceration in our community. Additionally, I've had conversations with local council members here and can share with you their concerns about drug policy reform or drug reform policy, where they do support largely ending the war on drugs. They recognize that there is a lot of underlying support systems that have to be built that go far beyond just offering treatment of additional pharmaceuticals or drugs to end addiction, but also to support people in transitioning into lives that that are healthy. So my PowerPoint is really about that. So let me pull that up. It'll just be a moment here. Okay, so as Larry mentioned, we are Decriminalized Nature, and our intention with this presentation is to show how we believe we can be a big part of supporting the drug full drug decrim policies as part of our process that we're rolling out here in California. And as background, we're also working with our state senator in the state of California, who is now recently announced 2 weeks ago to pass legal psychedelic decriminalization and legalization language. And so our city, City of Oakland, City Council, as well as ourselves, our city lobbyists, and others will be working with him to push for these kinds of programs. So the first thing I want to point out is that as an organization, we are about love and all that emerges from love. And we're confident in saying that because that is really what we are born out of. Our intention is to come with compassion, to promote equity, cooperation, justice, and all the things that emerge from that: abundance, equitable access, community building, and enabling people to find their own paths to healing, which we believe is what's a large part of what's missing in our society, self-empowerment. Just as a reminder about where the war on drugs is and the entire history of wars that we as communities have experienced, and really here I'm talking about a brown person from the BIPOC community. That's my own personal perspective. War on liberty 3,000 plus years ago really speaks to the process of colonization that began to happen with people's losing rights to land and to self-governance. And then from there, we saw the war on consciousness. Anyone who wants to learn more about that can simply read The Immortality Key. That's a bestseller that just came out last year. And then from there, slavery. 500 years ago, the efforts to end citizens' rights of participation, the war on civil rights, the war on immigrants, the United States, very real, 170 years ago onward, 100 years ago as well. We've had wars against the Mexican community, the Chinese communities. And then in the 70 years ago, we saw television advertising and things that reinforced for people of color how unworthy we were of participating in dominant society. And this has been just a consistent onslaught. And then 50 years ago, we see the war on drugs begin with Nixon full force. And then 40 years ago, we see the war on the poor that was really initiated by Reagan in cutting a lot of social programs. And that's where a lot of mental health recipients were cut out of the system and then ended up on the streets, at least here in the United States and in California especially. Decrim Nature really attempts to go back to the war on consciousness and to serve people in their desire to expand their awareness, expand their consciousness, break free from what Michael Pollan has called the default mode network, where we're stuck in this constant loop of self-hate, of a bad narrative, a narrative that keeps us in a state of anxiety, in a state of fear. For me, this was my state that I found myself in when I did a heavy dose of mushrooms and found my way out of it and understood at that point what benefits plant medicines present to society. And since then, I've been an advocate. Why plant medicines? Trauma is intergenerational, and the wars against our ancestors are relevant and carry with us today. They don't end when you die. They carry on generation to generation to generation, and they're cumulative. Trauma narrows the individual's personal options of pathways out of self-destructive thoughts and behavior. the default mode network. Plant medicines expand neural pathways and available for self-analysis by expanding dendrites and axons and reinvigorating neural pathways that had senesced due to trauma since, in many cases, since early childhood, people who experienced trauma from a very young age. What Dr. Sean Jenright might call persistent traumatic stress exposure, which is what we experience in BIPOC communities where stress is constant, fear is constant, anxiety is constant. It's not an acute PTSD event, it's chronic stress over many years. And so that narrows the neural pathway to be really a reaction, a response to anxiety and fear that often leads to addiction, that often leads to violent behavior in our communities and aggressive behavior. Plant medicines can help us get through that, and they create a sense of oneness and interconnectedness with other people on, with people, with life, and with the planet. Plant medicines can be grown by anyone and cost next to nothing. This is what Larry was talking about. And they've been used for thousands of years and are very low risk. In fact, mushrooms, psilocybin mushrooms are some of the lowest risk, if not the lowest risk, what we might call medicine that is known. Most BIPOC communities don't heal in clinics or hospitals, they heal in communities. And in particular in my culture, we tend not to, we rarely go to clinics. More often than not, we're healing with family in community or with friends. Extended families and community networks are still very strong in BIPOC communities. As a survival tactic, we've had to rely on community networks to survive in the world due to poverty, due to lack of opportunities, lack of education. We tend to rely more on community. For a person with deep trauma, community containers of people they can actually relate to are the safest ways to emerge out of deep trauma and into exploring new opportunities. So we advocate for a model that really supports community containers. Community-based healing creates a safety net for those needing to leave negative relationships or behaviors. Communities of healing groups of healing can enable the creation of networks of support. And we're doing that here in Oakland, where some of the organizations that go beyond plant medicine to creating, helping people with resumes, helping them get jobs, helping them find better nutrition habits, helping them with wellness. And then finally, communities of healing can begin to work to heal their own neighborhoods and eventually transform their cities. And really what we're getting at here is fundamentally the transformation of community neighborhoods and communities through healing the individuals who then work as community. And this is happening in Oakland. So we actually have real models here where this is working. I won't go into this slide as I'm getting short on time, but the short of it is that we are a community-based ceremony model, bottom up, and we advocate for abundance and compassion. Our priorities as an organization and what we're pushing for here in the city of Oakland and in the state of California is full decriminalization of entheogens without limits, grow, gather, gift, legal protections from state and federal prosecution for those providing community-based ceremony. And this is important because many people out there who are true healers in our communities don't get certifications for therapy to become therapists or don't get certifications to become or licenses to become doctors. They're healing and holding space for their own community as shaman, as space holders, facilitators, curanderos, medicine people. And we want to honor them, protect them. This is our ordinance that's coming to council in December 15th this year, and so in 2 weeks. Finally, we want to create community-serving micro-businesses that actually support local communities. And this came from the question we asked, what happens when you wake someone up from that very deep trauma-based default mode network and suddenly they find themselves realizing that they want options in life, and we realize we have to create local jobs, local opportunities. And so what we're advocating for is that when we are creating community-based ceremony, the jobs to support that through cultivation, distribution, go to local community residents in that same community. And this is part of our OCHI model. Finally, we want to do community-based public health research through observational studies that really look at how people are healing in our communities, not in a far-off medical facility or in a university, but in our community. So we want to do community-based research led by our own community to show what the effects of plant medicine healing in community containers can do. And that's my presentation. Thank you.
Great. Great. Thank you so much, Carlos and Larry. And I'll pass it over to Pete, but I'm so grateful that all of us can be joining here today on this discussion, because what's happening for you in the United States is parallel to what's happening with us, with our Indigenous population in Canada. And I want to acknowledge that we are on unceded territory, and so grateful to be here all as guests. And, you know, in Canada, the Indigenous population is 5% of Canada's greater population, and yet a third of the individuals in prisons are from Indigenous background. And so those numbers are shocking. And again, going back to the downtown east side, the largest population of individuals with addictions in one place in North America, again, many of the numbers in that community are Indigenous. And so Pete, my question for you is, and you're getting the live update from the Decrim discussion right now. My first question for you is, after seeing what Carlos and Larry have presented, has there been any discussion regarding, and I know it's early on, but has there been any discussion in regards to the use of plant medicine and entheogens as part of this greater structure for decriminalization?
Well, first off, thank you for acknowledging. Yes, we are coming live from the Coast Salish, the traditional territories of the Coast Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh people. I'm in the downtown east side near what was once called Kumkumale, which was the big maple grove. And yes, this neighborhood is disproportionately impacted, and Indigenous people bear the brunt of a lot of the war on drugs, institutionalized poverty, the legacy of residential schools, which is a uniquely Canadian piece, perhaps, that our American friends may not be aware of, but we have a deep sort of systemic racism that was perpetuated on the Indigenous people that tried to erase their culture that they still bear the scars of today in a very significant way. To the subject of plant medicines, you know, Canada is now effectively legalized cannabis. And we have, when we met Salimeh, we were in fact, we were challenging a very anti-plant medicine member motion from a council member that was really targeting psilocybin and really painting it in a very negative light and using some fear-based, very inaccurate and disingenuous kind of narratives around plant medicines. And that's where we connected. And that motion was defeated. And we talked about bringing some more assertive positions towards plant-based medicines. But in discussion at the time, there was so much going on, and the timing wasn't quite right. Of course, since that time, we now find ourselves in an incredibly different situation with COVID. And with the COVID-19, what we've seen is an immediate impact is it has amplified the dangers of people using drugs alone, people overdosing because they're no longer accessing facilities safely. And what we know is that, you know, criminalization of drug use and is directly contributing to overdose deaths. So where we have people who may otherwise be afraid to access services that could be life-saving, we recognize we have a problem. So what's happening in today's conversation with the mayor's motion around decriminalization is it's essentially an advocacy piece because we have to ask the federal government to grant us an exemption known as a Section 56, which is what they did for supervised injection services 15 years ago. So it is something that they can do. Interestingly, this where the success lies is that this likely will have the full support of council. This has the support of the local health authority. And this has the support not only of the police department and the police chief, but our chief of police, Adam Palmer, is also the president of the Canadian Association of Police Chiefs. And they, the National Board of Police Chiefs, have advocated this position for decriminalization of personal possession of drugs, which is an extraordinary move considering where we were even 5 years ago. So I think we're seeing a confluence of all these sort of urgencies, and I think this is the time for us to see a real change. And I think that this motion will pass at council today. What it looks like and how it's operationalized will be the next part of the conversation. And in that, we need to be sort of aware. I know that there's some critiques coming out of the Portland model that was recently passed decriminalization that has a lot of sort of coercive elements to the decrim side. So yes, it's decriminalized, but only if you pay a, you know, but you'll have to pay a fine or you can go into some kind of treatment. So we're observing some of those aspects. And again, it'll be a while before it comes to us specifically, because first we need to get that federal exemption, and that'll be the first hurdle. But I think we'll see it pass here. What happens at the federal level is the next question.
Thank you so much, Pete, for that timeline and the background of what the next steps are. So give us a little bit more information regarding that timeline. I know COVID has, you know, halted a lot of things, but what, when would the government have to reply by?
Well, we face a, there's a political dynamic in this country that that we've been grappling with this opioid overdose epidemic for 5 years now. It only became a national emergency in the last year when it started to really impact Central Canada and Toronto, the largest city in the country. So there's we're well ahead of the sort of curve on this issue, and unfortunately we sometimes feel kind of isolated here on the West Coast because we're so disconnected from the seat of power in Canada, which is Central Canada, Ontario, and Quebec. So a lot of it will depend, because the nature of Parliament is that the weight, the power is disproportionately weighted towards Central Canada. So it will unfortunately have to be either an exemption that is immediately just granted by the Minister of Health, who recognizes that this is, and I think that may well be the case. So the Minister of Health, Patty Hajdu, does recognize that this is a step that we as a nation need to go, and as most, it is probably a life-saving position for governments to take, that we are willing to do it, that we have a city that's willing to do it, that we have a police force that's willing to do it, that we have a local health authority that's willing to do it, that we have a province, the premier's come out in support of this, so that we have a lot of momentum here in British Columbia and specifically in Vancouver. So I think that they may well say, well, okay, sure, let's try it out in Vancouver and see how this works out, because it'll test the assumption that we generally think this will be a successful opportunity to provide life-saving interventions and refocus. And I think as the national kind of conversation, most of us recognize that addiction and drug use is more of a health issue than a criminal issue, especially when it comes to personal possession. There's no sense in criminalizing it and ruining somebody's life over possession of some medicines. So I think as a nation, we're ready for that. And I think we'll probably see it emerge here first and hopefully spread across the country.
I got it. And I want to continue a little bit with this. Carlos and Larry, thank you for your patience as we continue with the Canadian dialogue, because I know we have limited time with Pete, and then we'll jump back to the US initiatives. But my next question around that is, yes, absolutely. It's great that Vancouver can set an example. And we're very happy with Patty Hajdu, Health Minister Patty Hajdu, because as many of you who are listening and are part of the community know, that there are many different streams going on in regards to the access to plant medicines at this time in Canada. And Patty Hajdu has actually given authorization for the use of psilocybin to Theracil for patients at end of life anxiety and depression who are actually dealing with terminal illness. And so 10 of these exemptions have been given to Theracil, which is an incredible company based out of Victoria under Dr. Bruce Tobin and his team. And so we've already had an opening in that regards as well. However, it's limited because those individuals have to go to a therapist that's with designation. And so my next question is in regards to what Carlos and Larry have shared in regards to community-based healing. Now we have an immense amount of underground practitioners right now in Vancouver who are working diligently. It's very close to my heart because I actually have a client who has gone back to street drugs in the past week, and I've been dealing with the family and herself, and she's this incredible young woman, and I know she's going to make it through. But there are millions of these individuals right now in our country who are suffering. And so how do we ensure that, and I love when Carlos and Larry said this to me the first time, they said communities know how to heal their own population and their own community members. So how do we ensure that this dialogue is continued? And I would love to hear a bit more about your stand on it, Pete.
Well, we've definitely, one of the big approaches that we've taken as a local health authority, as a city, as just in governance, is really trying to shift some of the stigma out of because what we see is that a lot of stigmatization is what's driving riskier behavior. It's driving behavior underground. It's leading to a lot of conflict. It's leading to, arguably, through the direct result is an increase in overdose deaths, because we see so many people who are, and we have some really powerful sort of compelling narratives coming out from families who are impacted by the opioid overdose epidemic. But it's symptomatic of our sort of attitudes towards drugs. And as we're seeing folks come forward and say, you know, this is the byproduct of how we treat people who use drugs, how we treat drug use. And it's put my child or my loved one or my parent into a riskier situation that has resulted in their death or significant injury with a brain injury. So that, I think, is probably the most significant kind of like shift that we may need to make as a society. And it's a challenge because we do, you know, the center of drug addiction in the city of Vancouver is dirty. It's scary for a lot of people. It's not pleasant. There's lots of pleasant things about it and lots of spirit and good people, but the narrative in the media is consistently, it's always prefaced by downtown east side, quote, a troubled neighborhood. And it's always framed in that sort of aspect. And it always, you know, focuses on the worst aspects of it. And I think that's where we need to start to shift some of those narratives. And because as long as we take that focus, and other people, I think we'll have a hard time getting behind a national dialogue. And what we know is, I think Vancouver's doing a pretty good job in destigmatizing. And we, you know, in the downtown east side, we have lots of services. We have fire department who's like, you know, the recovery rate's quite good. What we're not seeing is in the other parts of British Columbia, in our neighboring province in Alberta, where people aren't living in urban centers, where there's those kind of resources and that kind of understanding. That's where we're seeing sort of a real sort of emergent problem that I think that we need to, that's where we need to shift it on a national level, so that we're not allowing people to fall through the cracks if they're not in an urban environment. Because increasingly with fentanyl poisoning, of course, and the toxic drug supply, is it's not just people who are regular addicts, who are, you know, using in a back alley kind of thing. These are people who are just weekend chipping away, having some party drugs or whatever, where the supply has been toxified. And I think that's where the other danger is, and why decriminalization is going to be a critical part. So one of the other things we have that's emergent is drug testing. So drug testing labs that allow folks, and this is where the decriminalization piece comes in. If you're coming in with your personal drug, you can actually have your drugs tested and make sure that you're not getting something that you're not expecting.
Got it. Yeah, it seems like we're just at the beginning of the dialogue, because this motion, as I understand it, is only looking at simple possession. So when we think about other structures that need to be created around this harm reduction model, and again, Vancouver has been a leader in harm reduction, as you mentioned, Insight, first safe injection site in all of North America, as well as we have Naomi and the Salome program, which are the prescription heroin programs that are also the only ones in North America. Now there are more first safe injection sites in Victoria and Ottawa and Toronto, but Vancouver really had to fight for that. And in 2003, you know, went to the Supreme Court around it. So I know we've oftentimes had this back and forth with the government and with the federal government, especially at that time, because it went into the conservative government and they pushed back around Insight. But these kinds of structures are so important, and absolutely 100%. I agree with you that the stigma, it has to be a humanitarian issue at this point. It has to be seen as a health issue. It has to be seen as a fiscal crisis, because there's so much money that's being wasted in regards to these services. Some of the numbers that I was seeing were close to, so one of the stats showed that $454 million were directed annually to Canada's drug strategy. $426 million of that, so 94% of it, was devoted just to enforcement. So what happens when that opens up, right? Where can we start to allocate that money? And how can we create these safe centers where people can do more than just have safe injection and access to harm reduction, but really where my dream would be that there would be access to cannabis and psilocybin as a bridge. And our Indigenous communities can bring in their ways of healing and their modalities. That's really ultimately what we need to set up as these healing hubs around our city. So right now, the issue is around possession. It's not distribution, right? And that's what I worry about, because if they're just talking about possession, then someone who's about to share, how does that come into being? So what's your strategy? And then I'm going to pass it over to Carlos and Larry with their insights on what was shared.
And I will have to get running back to council pretty soon as I see the clock on the wall. Unfortunately, it's one step at a time. I know there's been, I've had plenty of emails from advocates and people who are asking for more additions to this decriminalization motion that essentially is an ask of the federal government. So it's not even really our call to make. And my caution would be that we need to walk before we run on this one, and it may be too soon to, I think decriminalizing personal possession is the first step. I think when you get into distribution or trafficking, or those become sort of other areas that become a little bit beyond the scope of what we're immediately asking. I agree that it's a larger conversation that we have to have, but I don't think now is the time. I think soon will be the time, but it will also depend on what the outcomes and what the success of this looks like. Because, I mean, there's a challenge in us as a city doing it in isolation from the rest of the nation, obviously, because we could see effects of more of an influx of a certain kind of population or demographic or different kind of impacts that will disproportionately impact our city, which has a limited tax base. And when we start looking into the jurisdictional components of, I mean, in the city of Vancouver, for instance, everything that we police is, for all intents and purposes, is a provincial responsibility. Everything from housing and homelessness to mental health and addictions to the social service welfare rates to education to health. These are all provincial responsibilities that are not being met and then end up sort of being policed or what have you by the city of Vancouver, or, you know, first responder services. We pay taxes for fire rescue, those kind of things. So there's a fiscal kind of reality to this. There's a jurisdictional reality to this. So there's a lot of kind of complicated pieces that will sort of unfold as they unfold. But as long as we're having a larger conversation, I think that we're heading in the right direction. It may be a little slow, though. Mm-hmm. And on that, I have to run.
I understand. Thank you so much for joining us. And we'll share this replay with you so that you can hear the insights shared by Larry and Carlos. Thank you so much again, Pete.
Nice to virtually meet you all. Thanks.
So Carlos and Larry, hearing a bit about the what's going on in Vancouver and the structure that Pete just shared, what are some of your ideas and thoughts on that?
Yeah, thank you. So there is a reason why the Decrim Nature movement really is a people's movement. The intention of it is to rebuild the people's movement towards mobilizing and demanding change. There's two things that I learned in government. One is that the people working within government are actually pretty well intentioned for the most part. They come in, particularly elected officials, they come in with love in their heart. They want to do the right thing. They have all the best of intentions. But also the other thing I learned is that there are two directions that power and control flows. One is up and the other is down. For the last 3,000 years, we've been really participating as a society that really has sucked power in an upward direction, sucked decision-making in an upward direction, authority in an upward direction. In that process, we've disempowered people from making their own decisions about their own health. my three children were born at home with midwives and doulas, and we had to fight our insurance company to enable our children to be born with midwives here in the United States because there is such a push to give birth in hospitals. But when my wife and I did the research, we realized that very few births actually lead to emergencies. And so for us, having a very intimate experience was much more important than the bright lights birthing center of a hospital. But really, it's the what we're seeing that happened with midwives, which is the sucking of the power and authority of the midwives who've been giving birth for millions of years, got sucked into a medical framework. We've seen the same thing with our own healing capacities. And so what we're trying to do is really send the message that it's time that the elected officials stop for a moment and think. We're doing the same thing over and over and over again. And we're now in a crisis of people killing themselves or people dying from dangerous drugs. We're losing our fight to save our environment and our planet, and we have to change how we do things. And so we have to look at the flow of capital and profits in upward direction, increasing number of billionaires, increasing control in the highest levels of government, decreasing wealth in our communities. While Wall Street in the United States jumps in a very upward direction, our Main Street is dying in our cities. And so this we just have to look at the issues of control and power and how those are being distributed. I appreciate what the council member said, but I think we really have to start believing in communities more than we do as elected officials and as those in bureaucracies and hand back control to people to heal. Otherwise, we're going to continue to lose the battle and people will continue to die.
Thank you so much for that powerful share. And I can see in the chat box that many people are really appreciating the values that you and Larry are putting forward.
Should I add something?
Please, Larry, yes.
Good. And yes, I'm in total agreement with what Carlos said. And I think, you know, we talk about reducing stigma. And I think even the conversation we hear there, how do we reduce the stigma around distribution equal trafficking? You know, distribution is sharing among community. Distribution, those are the definitions, an exchange between two people. And so to really allow, or maybe that's the concern, to allow for maybe a new definition of that so it can involve sharing with community, because I think that's really, really critical here. And I think, you know, Carlos spoke this as well. You know, these sort of more progressive policies have been happening in Vancouver since, I think you said 2003 roundabouts. So 2003, yet this year, there was a dramatic increase in overdose deaths and other things like that, and toxic drug supply and those types of things. So maybe it is time just to try a new model. Maybe it is time to try a model that involves community, that involves ceremony, that involves people coming together, that isn't removing them from that place into a special safe injection site, but finding a way to come in community and ceremony for healing. And I think that's really, really an important thing here. You know, it's time to start new things. It's time to try new models. It's you know, that's what 17 years now that's been happening. And yet there's still the same kind of challenges that have been happening as of 17 years ago. So here we know that plant medicine can be really helpful, can be really beneficial, that can help people find a way out, that can be done in a way that's, you know, relatively safe, those types of things. And so why not try new models as we sort of move forward? And this is the time to sort of build off of that. So I think the movement that's happening in the US, the movement that's happening in Canada, really sort of advocate for the people's want to try something new to get out of some of the old habits that we have.
Yes. Exactly. I so appreciate both of your shares. And I really do feel that us as members of the plant medicine community are creating and asking for an alternative, because the systems that have been set up are imploding. Right now, one of the main reasons why so many of the illicit substances in Vancouver are have fentanyl and have benzos in them is actually because of what some of the pressures of COVID. So because of the borders closing, a lot of the actual substances have been reduced. And so the dealers are mixing in more of the opioids inside the drugs and passing them over. So right now we're just coming into even more and more of a bottleneck. And it's like, how much more can we survive this old model? And so I agree with you, Larry. And And the, you know, the discussion has to be open now with Canada. Like there is something about the United States that's very different, because you guys have been able to get, and maybe it's just because of the population of the US, you have been able to get a lot of movement with municipal governments. And they've been able to hold this container for their people, at least within their own city. So tell me a little bit more about that. And I also want to circle back to what happened with Measure 109 and 110 in Oregon in regards to, decriminalizing all substances, which Oregon did that, and also allowing for the psychotherapy of psychotherapists for the use of psilocybin. And so in Oregon, it wasn't a measure decriminalizing all entheogens. And so please share a little bit more about the differences that took place there.
Thank you. I'll leave the 109 for Larry and 110 a bit, but I did want to say that if you looked at our values that someone posted on and complimented, thank you for that. Our values, we do really come from love. That was a core value that we chose right out of the gate. That's our path. That's where we walk. And from that comes compassion, abundance, all those things. When we made that choice, we knew that whenever we were going to pass a policy or advance a policy, we had one fundamental question we wanted to ask. And I invite all of your leaders and everyone in who is a therapist and others to do this. How will the most vulnerable person in your society, in your community, benefit from what you're doing? Not how will people benefit, how will the most vulnerable? Because what ends up happening over and over and over again is we pass policies. This happened in cannabis extensively in the US. We pass policies because it feels good that we're going to finally decriminalize cannabis. And then it ends up being that when we legalize, venture capital came in and took all the opportunities, and black and brown people were kicked to the wayside. And so if you look at the most vulnerable people in our society, they're not getting access to the medicines that they need, natural or otherwise. And so everything we do, we're asking the question, how will the unhoused person in Oakland get access to what we're proposing? We hold ourselves accountable in that way. And that's an important question, because you begin to see your blind spots. You begin to see your own hypocrisy in what you, collective you, are proposing if you're not asking that question in the medicines you're bringing forward. And this is a really important moment in human history, because we're talking about medicines, plant medicines, with a really profound power to heal consciousness. And this is kind of the last hurrah, if you will, for humanity to get it right. This is our perspective. And so we did start with municipalities, because municipalities are closer to the ground. Elected officials at cities or counties can directly hear from their constituents. I worked in the congressional office. We were very detached. We very rarely spoke to citizens in the field. It was very theoretical policymaking, and this is the problem. When you get into the state or federal level, you're not really having a direct interaction with residents. You're having direct interaction with lobbyists or advocates representing people. And so municipalities are good, because you can build a direct relationship where then you actually can pass policies that are compassion-based. And this is why we've been having success. 25 yeses, zero no's. In the cities where we passed it, Washington, D.C. is 63% people of color and passed 76% affirmative. We're seeing our biggest growth in decriminalized nature from Black, Indigenous, people of color, Latinos, because the people are realizing what we're representing here is a shift in paradigm, no longer top-down control, bottom-up. And I guess I'll kick over to Larry the 109, 110 answer.
Why do I always have to follow you? So as Carlos said, yes, absolutely. And, you know, we were having a lot of conversation with 109 and 110 throughout the many years, or the year, I should say. And we really wanted to sort of advocate, you know, 109 began with decriminalization language involved in that. And that done language was taken out. And then 110 happened, which was the decriminalization. And 109 was the sort of therapeutic use, or, you know, within a sort of particular model. But through that model, you know, everything is being sort of run by the Oregon Health Authority. So that means, you know, all the growing, all the, like, the licensure, all that thing is happening through a system which, as Carlos said, is a top-down system. And oftentimes, I'm guessing the Oregon Health Authority doesn't really know too much about the deep sort of relevance and the nuances of what it is to hold ceremony or to be in ceremony, to, you know, have traditional practice, to be apprentice, so, you know, what the types of things that are happening and the experiences are. Now, granted, there's a lot of people who are helping out with that and sort of their training and that type of thing. But one of the things that we notice is kind of a concern is that you have, anytime you have the creation of special permits, oftentimes there's an enforcement of those permits, which means that now, for example, you might not be able to have your own community-based ceremony because that would be sort of eating into the market share, so to speak. You know, there's publicly traded companies that are moving into Oregon, for example, Field Trip Health, which is out of Toronto, Canada. I think they just wrote a PR that says they're really excited to make things happen in Oregon, which is great for them. But unfortunately, there's a lot of really, really talented people in Oregon that are maybe going to get cut out of that because they're not able to get that license. They don't have the money to make it happen, all that type of thing. M110 was a great idea in terms of the decriminalization. But again, same thing as is in Vancouver. It's just we're focusing on possession and actually has some language in there that, you know, does, you know, there's certain limits, you know, prohibition is still for growing. You can't grow. That's still a felony. For harvesting, that's still a felony. As I mentioned earlier, there's an article today where park rangers were trying to figure out what is the law exactly? Are people able to harvest? And so it's still a felony to harvest. So in terms of being able to have access to nature, being able to have your own sort of agency around that, that's still not allowed really in Oregon. So now you have these two systems, which are top down and really don't allow for this community-based access. And then also with M110, you know, it creates a system where, you know, it's still an e-violation. So there's still an incentive for a police officer to stop a citizen. Whereas in Oregon, you know, if somebody sees plants or mushroom material, you know, by the resolution, that would be something that wouldn't even be an issue to like check to see how much does it weigh? Does it weigh over a certain amount? And in the M110 initiative, there is a cap. So the key with a cap is that it says 12 grams, for example, with mushrooms, 12 grams of mixture of substance with a quote unquote detectable amount of psilocybin. So that means if I had a 13 gram chocolate bar with a microdose of psilocybin, that would be still a misdemeanor under that model. So there's a lot of things that we were kind of hoping that maybe there would be less restrictions around plant and fungi material because, you know, growing a tomato out of your backyard, growing oranges out of your backyard, growing natural plants and materials should be allowed for anyone to just, you know, enjoy and sort of be able to participate in. And so, and then also within that too, there's, as Carlos was saying in his slideshow, creates a treatment program, which is to the tune of $100 to $120 million a year taken from the cannabis fund, which extracts it from, you know, education, these types of things, and create a system where it's kind of this revolving door system without an opportunity for really, and doesn't even really mention plant medicines or those types of things, which could actually be really helpful and help people get off of that sort of revolving door system versus just kind of being back into it. So we hope that in the future, you know, in our sort of negotiations over the year, we could see a really great program happening where all three of those are combined, you know, decriminalization, allowing for, you know, growing your own, gathering your own, being in ceremony, being in community, decriminalization that allows a treatment for allows people to be able to help when they're in situations that are more challenging, and then also having a therapeutic system for people that's going to be the model that really works for them. Just as much as for some people that can only, you know, have experiences in community-based ceremony, there's also people that therapeutic model is really the best way for them to go, and that's great, and that's, we are in support of all of them. But without decriminalization first, it creates access restrictions, and then there's bottlenecks, and people aren't able to have, you know, an experience unless they go to that place, and you know, the cultural ethos and the cost is often too high for some folks. So this is something that we're really kind of hoping as things move forward, there can be some sort of unification between these to allow for both the decriminalization of plants and mushrooms, that type of thing, for growing your own, for being able to make your own, that type of thing, be able to share it in ceremony, as well as the other projects.
We're hoping we can get it right in California through Senator Scott Wehner and his two sponsors in the assembly. That we would do that kind of coalition-based legislation that supports community, clinical, medical, and we can, yeah, do something that the rest of the nation can emulate and hopefully be a model for other countries as well.
Wonderful. I appreciate that model of the community and then the therapeutics and then the medicalization being at the top, because access to that is the hardest and access to community base will actually be easier. So now with what you shared, Larry, in regards to what happened in Oregon, if you have the steps moving forward, what are your intentions to include that missing piece of decriminalization of plant and fungi?
I would say, well, I mean, this is what we're kind of working on within California, and it seems like there's a lot of I don't want to say the word monkey see, monkey do. But, you know, a lot of people are like, oh, this thing over here, we're going to do that thing over here now because, you know, it worked over there. And so really just being able to maybe sort of get the word out that this is an important piece because it wasn't really sort of mentioned in those two things. So other people that see state legislation passing, they're just going to want to replicate that. And so we're really trying to get in with all those folks to make sure that they understand that there's another thing that could be very helpful. And, you know, like I say, the fiscal responsibility, all the, you know, health, safety, all these types of things could be benefited if all those are looked at together. It costs a lot less if somebody doesn't have to go to treatment every couple months, but they can actually just have an experience that really helps them get out of that sort of cycle, like with some of the plant materials and that are available. But I think, you know, if we can make things happen in California, that will really make a big statement and hopefully then move its way through the rest of the conversation. But in the meantime, we're not stopping in terms of decriminalization of nature. We have groups in Oregon still working to make sure that they can be able to grow, gather, and gift as well in Portland and Eugene and Bend and other places. We're also working in other cities across the U.S. that are doing this. I think, you know, currently have 30 plus active cities and well over 100 cities where people have reached out and are starting to organize and that type of thing. So we continue to build the movement. We continue to reduce the stigma. We continue to get the word out and educate people about the benefits of these plants and medicines, plant and fungi medicines. And hopefully that will be able to change some minds as we move forward. To use Michael Pollan's phrase.
Carlos, anything? I mean, the state legislation in California, we hope will pass in 2021. We hope it will contain the decriminalized nature framework as well as our community healing model, which is the community ceremony and community-based container for the most vulnerable.
That's coming up pretty soon, too, so that allows us to have a good opportunity to sort of re-engage that conversation, and that's in about 2 weeks, so that's pretty exciting. Carlos is working his butt off for that one, so good job.
Yeah, we're coming to council to pass both a resolution and hopefully the ordinance, which will protect underground practitioners, offer legal protections against federal prosecution for underground facilitators who are engaged in safe practice. You underground facilitators who are listening, you know what safe practice looks like. Most of you do. And so we've written 8 major points that define what safe practice really is and good practice really is. And if you're engaging in those, then the city council would, the city attorney would offer you legal protections in exchange for signing on to the commitment to engage in safe practice. This is our way of sending the state of California a message that our particularly marginalized communities are going to rely on this model to heal. It will be the first time, I think, in Western history, history of Western civilizations at least, that we have introduced municipal code changes that enable ancient wisdom practices and ceremony to come back into an urban environment.
And I think another thing that's important with this whole model is that rather than a top-down model where everything is sort of set in stone, this really allows for the emergence of new culture of, like I said earlier, these kind of cultures that kind of rub together and they're like, oh, I've been trying this thing underground for a really long time, but nobody knows about it because it's, you know, been underground. And, well, me too over here. And so you really can see a blending of new models, new ways, new approaches that are traditional, that are ceremonial, that are contemporary, but really speak to the, you know, culture of the individuals who are working with it and also kind of coming up with new practices and things like that. And, you know, there's a big network throughout the U.S. called the Clean Eating Network, which has been doing really great work for a long time, and really be able to share between communities some of these new practices without sort of etching everything in stone that's unchangeable.
Really good. Well, that's very exciting to hear about California, and I wish you guys both the best and the team the best as you move forward with that. And that's one of the things that I appreciated, again, so much about your initiative is that you casted a wide net from the beginning. It was like, bring in all of the sacraments and allow individuals to connect with them, just like how it's our basic human right. But sometimes I feel that in the multi-stream process of medicalization, legalization, and decriminalization, when the legalization has gone, and we've seen it with cannabis, as Carlos brought it up, it's been devastating because when legalization goes first, and many of us are about to watch it happen in Canada, you know, in some ways it's inevitable. All the people who position themselves for cannabis to go legal are positioning themselves for psilocybin to go legal. And for me, this is not the path. These medicines, everything that they teach us is about connection, healing, humility, togetherness, right? C- connection back to our planet, helping each other, right? Nowhere does it say, go and make a lot of money with me. Like, who has sat in a ceremony and that's been the message that they've gotten? Why are we not even listening to the actual message that they're sharing with us? Like, how much more do we have to, you know, subjugate these messages with our own mind control and, like you guys are saying, corporate greed? So I really feel that the antidote to legalization not taking another terrible twist like it happened with cannabis is decriminalization. So I really, again, so appreciate the work that you're both and the team is doing.
Yeah, and you know, again, we're saying in addition to the other modalities. So if you're a therapist and you're advocating for a therapy model, that's fantastic. If you would also do us the kindness of also advocating in addition to the therapist model or decrim model, that way those who cannot afford therapy can afford their own medicines, grow their own medicines, and all could benefit from the gifts of our Mother Earth.
Exactly. Let me switch over to some of the questions that we have because some great ones are coming through. So someone says, if and when psilocybin becomes decriminalized, would someone who wanted to set up a business, such as a sanctuary, retreat, therapy, be required to have a medical certificate, such as PhD, etc.? So this is maybe a great segue into what you described as the Oakland Initiative.
Yeah, so there's several modalities, right, that are going to be initiated at the state level. In Oakland, we're really pushing because we understand where we sit in the whole conversation. We are a very diverse community. We have a very long history of social justice activism. This is the birthplace of the Black Panthers. And we've had some tremendous leaders come out of here who were progressive. So our niche, our role, if you will, is to advocate for access by our most marginalized communities, our communities of color, but as well everyone. And so what we are suggesting and through our ordinance is that for community-based ceremony, because it's community-based, that the enterprises that emerge to serve those, whether they're collectives, nonprofits, or for-profits, that they really be local in those in the city, serving those needs of those ceremonies. We're going to have pharmaceutical companies, we're going to have publicly traded companies, venture capitalists, serving the clinics, the pharmaceutical needs of clinical therapy, of medical, of pharmacies. So we know we're not going to compete in that arena in the community level, but we can serve our local community-based ceremony practices. And the way you can think about it is a local pub. In a local pub, you'll probably have 80% of your beers that are on tap are going to be local breweries in your neighborhood that are gaining support by being, and that's because that's what the public demands. The public doesn't want to go and have every single tap being Coors, Budweiser, and otherwise. So it's actually local breweries that are beginning to get a foothold in local communities, so they're local pubs. Same concept. The local growers, the local distributors, local service providers would be served through local community ceremony. And this is a really neat way, cool way, easy way of building jobs and opportunities in the same communities that are doing community-based ceremony. So to answer that question directly, if you were in our community, you'd have an opportunity to grow and serve our local community ceremony holders.
And thank you so much for that, Carlos. And before we hear from Larry, give us a little bit more specifics of that, because it sounds like you guys are creating the complete structure. So you have the streams of money and financial support coming in, but then your practitioners in Oakland will be able to practice as they feel called to and bring in the indigenous lineages in and their own training. So how will you ensure, because it's a fantastic, it'll be an example model, how will you ensure best practices, circle of care, ethics, if there's an issue with conduct, how will you ensure that? Will you be creating a separate body who will be looking at that? Because that's really what the CPA has come to represent, is that pillar strength where individuals can come if there have been any issues. And we are a body that holds space for all the different members of the community, whether they're doctors, facilitators, underground therapists, business owners.
First thing I'd say is we're going to do a bunch of things wrong, but we're going to do way more right. And it's important that people, getting back to that whole concept that power and personal control and agency has been sort of sucked in an upward direction. We've lost it at the local level to a great extent, our ability to heal ourselves. And so we're relearning how to work with these plants because it was taken from us by us, you know, in our growth as civilization. We've lost that over the years, but now we have to relearn it. And so this is the process of relearning and remembering how to work with our plant allies. And it's important that we be provided the space to try, to get it right, to make mistakes, to fix. So we have a group of very skilled space holders, facilitators in Oakland that have met and have created these safe practice guidelines. But we really wanted to make it guidelines because who are we to say how it should be done? Instead, what we're doing is we're creating space to create a culture where the leaders of this can have feedback real time from their participants, those who are participating in ceremony. And because of social media and because of the benefits of high tech and social media, we're going to learn really quick who the practitioners or facilitators are who are doing some very risky things, and they'll be called to the table because that's already happening in communities all over the world. So, and then what will emerge over time is, you know, from best practices will emerge rules that people follow, and it'll get a little bit more clear cut. But what we want to do initially is just leave a little space. We know that people are not going to do, and we're already holding the space, so we already kind of know what's going to happen, right? Because people are doing it just underground, and it's happening in all of our Black, Brown, Indigenous, and Asian and immigrant communities in Oakland already. So we already know what's going to happen, but we're going to learn as much as we can and try to encourage good adherence to the practices and guidelines.
That's fantastic. And I just love the way that your community is really weaving together in an organic moment by moment process. It seems like there's no, we know how it's going to be, or this is the way it's going to turn out. You're really saying, let's gather together, which is really responding to the medicine and allowing the medicine to lead before the people leading, and allowing the what needs to arise and to curate from there very collectively. So it's a beautiful intention.
Thank you.
No.
You're ready to go.
Okay. I would just kind of add to that. Yeah, you know, I mean, I think it was really important for us to, just like Carlos said, to not have all the answers, to know, to be humble enough to know that, you know, there's a lot of things out there that we don't know. There's a lot of styles and techniques that people want, and really allow for the engagement with the community-based organization and the facilitator to really see what qualities, what ethics, what things are really important, because it'll change from community to community. And then through that process, you can really start to see, like, you know, what's working, what's not working, that type of thing. And to allow then, rather than it be sort of in municipal code of what the XYZ have to do, these things are, to allow for there to be constant sort of interaction with the community-based organizations, sort of see what works, what doesn't work, you know, and to understand that, you know, we're in a place where we have to build culture, you know, we're so lost from that right now. And so to allow that to happen on our own terms, you know, within community, I think is really, really important, because that's, you know, but, you know, with the work I do with integration, a big part with integration is that we're so far removed from these experiences, we have to do the integration because the meaning making is so out there, you know. But now here we have an opportunity to really sort of build that sort of infrastructure mentally, psychologically, spiritually, as well as with the actual work, to see, like, you know, what works well, what types of meaning can be made. You know, one community might make meaning a different way than someone else, you know. And also be, you know, my idea would also be, like, to have an opportunity for different groups to make meaning by an exchange, you know, like maybe one group over here is doing some work and they go and do integration practices with someone over here who's doing a different type of work, and to really see what kind of comes from that, because, you know, we're at the very beginning of a very long marathon, which, you know, again, we had been doing for, we had been already running a pretty long marathon before it was stripped away from everybody. But now we have an opportunity to sort of reassess that, relook at what works, what doesn't work. And like you say, you know, find ways that are good for the people. So that's really exciting to see. You know, even with a PhD, I'm ready to go back to day one of school when this starts, because it's like, you know, we're going to be learning so much more from everybody. And I think that's really beautiful. And it's needed, you know, so we can encourage new learning and not just say, okay, well, here are these studies that say this thing, but like, hey, you know, what's going on here? You know, what kind of ways can we help people with something like cluster headaches? What kind of ways can we help someone with trauma? What kind of ways can we help someone with PTSD, which is a thing that isn't really being talked about? Carlos talks about this a lot, which is from Sean Jenright, I believe, from UCSF. It talks about post-traumatic stress environment, which is really, or persistent traumatic stress environment, which is really a different kind of avenue than PTSD, which is a sudden experience, but it's a long, prolonged experience. So really need to start looking at that. And one of the benefits also of doing the OCHI model is that it removes us from this sort of very expensive clinical trials where we're finding one thing that works, you know, FDA trials or for treatment-resistant depression in 3 or 4 or 5 years when that finally passes. With observational studies, it costs much less, and you can actually see what are the benefits to community over time. And this is going to be a very interesting way to kind of look at these plant medicines, these mushroom medicines, to see what are the benefits that aren't necessarily within a, you know, I mean, the laboratory setting or the clinical setting is kind of, it's not a real setting, so to speak, you know, but to do it in community, you do have that. So you can then know what's going to go on. You know, people aren't going to be, you know, it's not, for some folks, you know, it's so exotic, you know, that place, but really like, what is it like in community? What can I do in community? How is the next day for me? What is it like when I have to see the people that I'm always engaging with who may not understand the experience, or somebody that does understand the experience? You know, there's this interesting idea about transformation is that sometimes your close family and friends have some challenges with it because you're now a new person that they've been used to this other person, and now this new person emerges. And so how do you sort of engage with that process? There's a lot of things that we don't know through the sort of clinical research that we can find through observational studies and doing this type of work where things are naturally emerging, organically emerging. So it's really exciting from, you know, a healing process, from a community-based process, but also from a research and interest process.
Really well said, Larry. Thank you. I heard a lot regarding relational healing. So much of the work that we're doing, especially with plant medicines, is around each other and mirroring the different parts of ourselves to each other, healing within a community that's stable and that's consistent. And these are some of the pillars for harm reduction. Absolutely. And I know that at least some of the background in Vancouver, where, you know, where I have to give a lot of recognition to Anne Livingston and her colleagues back in the early 90s in Vancouver, when the HIV overdose crisis and the, you know, some of the first concerns regarding injections and sharing of needles became a major issue in Vancouver. That was early 90s, and her and her colleagues, because of this, because of that crisis at that time, started Vandu, and I think that was in 1998, and it was all based around this notion of community healing. So Vandu, which stands for the Vancouver Area Network of Drug Users, was about destigmatization around the philosophy of care for individuals. And from that, where Insight was created, upstairs of Insight was actually on site. So individuals with addictions could go upstairs to have access to a medical doctor, to an acupuncturist, and to be able to have just a talk with a counselor. And so we see that this does not work in the hospital. So all this money that's being, again, wasted when the ambulance personnel and the frontline workers come and take people into the hospitals, right away in the hospital setting, people tend to leave immediately, right after they get their medication so that they don't overdose. They get up and leave because A, there's a shortage of beds. B, they know that they're going to be pumped with other drugs at that time. And it's not a conducive space to, it's not even preventative. It's just emergency and get out, or they just leave. And so, you know, how, and we have quite the journey ahead of us, you know, and I feel that it doesn't have to be, it also doesn't have to be a model of suffering. It can truly be a model of care. Because if we, you know, if, for example, in Oakland, where you guys had decriminalization of psilocybin, the way that I envision these ceremonies is that, you know, 10, 15, 20 people, based on what they're coming in with, come in together. There's like a series of facilitators, 10 to 15 facilitators in all kinds of different backgrounds. And people go into the ceremony together. And afterwards, there's integration immediately. And because the plant medicines go to the root of the issue, as we know this, right? It's not just a preventative measure, it's going back to the complete root. But people need to be held when they go to the root of their trauma, because it can be also quite traumatizing if you're going there without support. And so how beautiful to bring in the whole community and create this vortex and container. And I really can't wait to see that happen in Oakland. And I hope that we have a chance to see that in Vancouver as well.
May I address, David Volrath has asked a number of questions regarding the Indigenous community. I think this is a really important point for us that I want to speak on, because right now one of our fastest growing voices in Decrim Nature, which we're grateful for, is the Indigenous community and leaders who are reinstituting ancient tradition of plant healing modalities. As we know, in the United States, there was a tremendous destruction of ancient ways of healing, or the intention and efforts to do that. And so a lot of it was swept away, but a lot of it was also retained. And one young man that I personally worship and pray at, Shane Norte, has started a church. This is part of what the petroglyph that Larry talked about. Their traditions go back hundreds, if not thousands of years, based on the petroglyphs with psilocybin mushrooms. And one of the things that we're seeing is a reemergence of ancient traditional ways of holding medicine space in Indigenous communities in the U.S. with plant medicines. Outside of the Native American church. Native American church was a response to colonialism here in the United States and an attempt to create a structure in which you can have legal use of peyote. But there are all these other indigenous communities that don't, or individuals who don't participate in the church framework, the Native American church, and have their own ways of doing it. And really that's what Decrim Nature is about, is that every individual, every community has their own ways of healing and doing ceremony. We're all different. All of our communities are different. And what Shane is doing is really incredible. It is about prayer. It is reconnecting to nature, where the medicine is really just a way of helping you reconnect with the beautiful environment that he brings you into. And we pray to the cedar trees, and we pray to the river for giving us the rocks, and the springs for giving us the water. And we just remember that being on this planet is a gift. And we emerge from the Wampkish, we emerge from the Sweat Lodge, as almost newborn entities, grateful for just being alive. And we have now veterans going to heal with Shane, people who come out of special ops, who have Navy SEALs, who have really struggled with PTSD, who are finding his type of ceremony very healing, because it is very back to basics. It is simply giving gratitude for being alive. And there's something very powerful about that. So I just wanted to honor the questions that David was asking, because we do need to figure out a way to support these ancient traditions that are being done by our Indigenous communities in the United States. And that has to be a core part of our emergence as an organization. So definitely supportive.
Thank you so much, Carlos, for that background, especially in regards to the use of peyote as a sacrament in the southern parts of the U.S. And in Canada, you know, we also have such a rich history and gifts from our Indigenous elders and communities. And a lot of them, even though there's been intergenerational trauma, a lot of them are so kind to open their doors and to share their teachings. I visited with several elders on Vancouver Island who who just share so generously. And I think we, you know, with now COVID and who knows how long this transitional time will be, but a lot of us don't have the chance to go into the Amazon at this time. And so we have so much richness of culture and support in the spiritual realms right here in North America. And a big part of, you know, our mission of the CPA is to continue to have these talks and bridge these communities. Because, you know, another piece that I want to answer to David's question is an Indigenous exemption. So another stream that we have to take as part of the CPA and working with one of our advisory members, Jasmine, who is actually, her background is with ayahuasca and with the Indigenous traditions of North America. And so she, you know, we have had some talks in regards to having exemptions and protection around the sacraments. And that's another way to be able to use these medicines, because right now, again, we're in a pressure cooker. And sometimes you can't just wait, as Carlos was saying, for the power-ups to give that permission. When are we actually going to be taking our permission back? And in a lot of ways, it's happening. You know, a lot of us are not waiting because we see individuals suffering. And it's an ethical duty, I feel, as a therapist, when there's harm to others or to yourself, that there has to be a call and there has to be a stand. And so this is really an important part of the self-empowerment and the sovereignty that Carlos and Larry were talking about. And, you know, how do we make that happen? I think more of us need to come together in the collective. And just like you guys are, you know, mobilizing. And so please, anyone who's watching this part of our community, again, if you want to get involved with the CPA or hear more about what's happening in Decrim, the Decrim Nature US movement, please feel free to reach out and let us know how you want to contribute. Now we have a growing body of volunteers. The CPA is also a board that's made of volunteers. And we're all just giving our heart and soul to this because we've been so healed by the medicines. And this is reciprocity. It is our...
You all are launching a Decrim Nature Canada. Is that what you're doing as well? Or is that part of CPA?
Yes. So as part of the CPA and the petition that we sent federally, it is our intention to create more dialogue and education around the Decrim movement. But as you can see, look, there's a little bit more structural steel energy around the Canadian government. And you guys are definitely having more momentum in the United States.
Plugging away, and hopefully some of our momentum flows in your direction.
Absolutely. But the other thing that we have in Canada that we're very grateful for is that at least the federal government and the municipal governments are not cracking down too much on the healing. And many of them, many communities actually know that the practitioners are using plant medicines and they're supporting them. And so, again, when I say that we have to do the work anyways, it's happening and they understand the individuals in enforcement, they understand that this needs to happen because their own family members are oftentimes affected as well. Yeah. Let's see. I want to just wrap up as well. Maybe we'll take one more question if it's okay for you, Carlos and Larry. Okay, great.
Hello.
This is a great question. I'm so glad someone has asked this. I just want to set this that what some people are asking regarding Portugal, and I know personally Switzerland have some great models. We won't cover that in this talk, but we will have a subsequent conversation with some, hopefully some members of VANDU, and we'll bring more of a drug policy and different international models in a future webinar. But I want to answer this one that's coming through. So Carlos and Larry, the question is, what is actively being done legislatively to work on getting marginalized non-criminal drug only first-time offenders as well and offenders out of prison? So in regards to the decriminalization that has happened in different cities, are you also working on getting individuals out of jail, the pardons, What does that look like?
Yeah, thank you for that. We've made a very clear intention that our process really is about institutional and structural reform in our society from the bottom up. I mean, hopefully what you've heard today, you recognize that what we're trying to do is undo a lot of the stripping individuals of their ability to heal, as well as bringing those benefits into the communities that have suffered and create and prevent people from going to prison. So our work is really preventative. The intention, as you heard throughout this conversation, is about looking at the most vulnerable as they march through the process of healing, finding new self-narratives that are very positive for them, that they can then find opportunities in front of them that bring them happiness and joy, and that they find communities. And this is really our work here at the local level. We're going to be working with our Oakland City Council to redistribute police funds towards healing and support, community support work, as opposed to enforcement as we go through this process. The vision for 20 years is that we create a city with full compassion towards all members of its society, shifting away from a model of enforcement and control. So that's our work. There are other groups such as Ella Baker Center and Drug Policy Alliance, and there's work being done by leaders in the cannabis industry to expunge and to help get people out of prison. We support them as we support the Drug Policy Alliance effort to decriminalize all drugs. But we understand where our lane is and what our work is, and it's a more proactive sort of visionary model of changing the way we do business, period.
Excellent. Thank you. Larry, do you have anything to share on that?
Nope.
Okay, awesome. Well, thank you so much. And I can see there's some more questions regarding what's taking place in Vancouver. And so if you missed the beginning portion, Councillor Pete Fry was with us. Please take a look at the replay of the webinar, which will be posted on the CPA website. You can see that and other past webinars at psychedelicassociation.net. And again, if you're not a friend of the CPA, please come onto the website, join us if you want to hear about future events, how you can get involved as a volunteer, or how you can just get your voice heard in regards to the future activities that we have in regards to training and the decriminalization movement. And if you found something that was valuable to you and you want to make a contribution so we can continue to do this great work with our webinars, please go ahead and donate on our website. And you can also hopefully donate to the Decrim Nature US movement and support Larry and Carlos and their teams to continue to do the good work.
Salimeh, thank you for having us on. It was wonderful.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. It was great. I look forward to more.
My pleasure. Thank you so much. You guys are, as always, so inspirational. I look forward to connecting very soon as well. Thank you for joining us.